Hello everyone, this is Nitpicking Nerd, and today I want to add something to my theory of how the Star Trek continuity keeps changing as a result of time travel. By the way, all of this is just for fun. I know it's not a real universe, I know it's just a TV show, but I always loved pointing out continuity mistakes, and even more, I love to come up with excuses to try to explain them. So everything I'm talking about, I'm sure none of the writers ever thought about. But fans love to debate these kinds of topics, to try to come up with excuses, so all of this is just for fun. So if you didn't already check out my video in which I explain my theory about how the entire timeline changed as a result of First Contact and other time traveling events, which caused humanity to get all kinds of technologies from the future, which basically boosted up the technological level of humanity in the past, and that's why technology seems to be more advanced in the prequels compared to the shows that take place after. Of course, the real reason is that the creators of these new shows simply don't care, but we can come up with this theory to try to make up excuses, which I think is fun. So I made a very long elaborate video to show how all the time traveling events can cause all the changes we see. And I'll sum it up briefly, basically because the Borg came back in time and the Enterprise E followed them in First Contact. Zefron Cochrane saw the Enterprise E through the telescope and later in space. Lily was also on the Enterprise. She also kept a pad that Picard gave her. She also saw the ship models in his observation lounge. And she roamed around the ship freely for a while before he found her. And so it's very likely that both Lily and Zefron were later involved in the project to build the first Warp 5 engines, and maybe they suggested that new model of the Enterprise, which became the NX-01, which did not exist in the original timeline, which also explains why we never saw the NX-01 in the motion picture. We saw in one scene all the past ships named Enterprise, and the NX-01 wasn't there. So the only explanation is that that movie was taking place in the original timeline before the changes in the timeline as a result of First Contact. And to add to that, we also know about the temporal Cold War. We know of people from the future giving technologies to different species in the past. The Suliban got a lot of technologies from the future, such as cloaking technology and many other things. And we also have human temporal agents from the future who are fighting all of that, sometimes by using the crew of the NX-01 to fight against the agents of those other people from the future who presumably are bad guys. And I also made a video about the theory that maybe those agents we saw from the future, maybe they're not even the good guys. You know, we see that they're human, so we assume they're the good guys, but maybe they're actually Section 31 or something like that. In one Voyager episode when we saw those agents, their uniforms looked kind of similar to Section 31, and even Daniels, who looks like a good guy, but he always wears those black outfits, so maybe they're all Section 31 agents who are actually manipulating events deliberately, trying to boost up technology of the humans in the past. And maybe for a good reason, maybe because other species are indeed doing that as well, and so to combat that, they also have to do that, to make sure that the Federation remains the most powerful organization in the galaxy. And he had a whole bunch of equipment from the future, which he left on Enterprise. He disappeared, and his equipment remained. And Archer gave an order to Reed to seal off that room with a big lock, so that no one can get any of that future stuff because it's too dangerous. And later on, in later seasons, he sometimes went into that room and did use a bunch of stuff from the room, but always kind of kept it to himself and sealed it back again. For example, one time they used something from Daniel's equipment to detect the cloaked ships of the Suliban, and later they even used that against the Romulans, who also had cloaking technology before the time they're supposed to. And the fact that Daniels or no one else from the future ever tried to take those things away from Archer to take them back to the future, no one ever did that, so my only conclusion is that they wanted him to have all that stuff. Maybe as a counterbalance to the bad guys also getting advanced technology before they're supposed to, like the Romulans, and so maybe this was a deliberate overlook by the future agency that they wanted Archer to have all that stuff. But now I want to get to my main point. We know that Archer didn't think he should be using all that stuff, so he ordered it to be sealed in that room, and presumably never gave it to Starfleet to be studied and reverse engineered, instead kept it hidden forever, maybe eventually destroyed it. But I want to closely examine exactly what happened in the meanwhile. Exactly, was that equipment really sealed off in that room all that time? So let's look at all the facts. We know that the one who actually locked that room was Lieutenant Reed, who we later found out was a Section 31 member. And he's the one who actually locked the door on that room, so presumably no one else had the codes to open that room, except for Reed. And just a few episodes later, in episode 14, Reed was the first one to introduce holographic target practice to the crew of the Enterprise. This was a big continuity mistake. Holograms a century before TOS. It was never even used in TOS, so it makes no sense for Starfleet to have holographic technology a century earlier. It's okay for other species to have holograms, other aliens which have more advanced technologies, that's all fine. But Starfleet shouldn't have had holograms in this point in time. And yet Reed apparently installs the holographic emitter to train the crew with holograms. And this was just three episodes after that episode in which he locked Daniel's devices in that room, and many of those devices had holographic technology. So could it be that Reed actually secretly took some of those devices and studied them and maybe created those holographic emitters, which Starfleet is not supposed to have yet? In later seasons, we saw the Makos also using holographic target practice, and they said something about it being new technology from the Jupiter station. So apparently Reed never took credit for basically inventing that technology, so maybe he sent information, he sent the specs on how to create holograms to someone else in Starfleet or to Section 31, and they are the ones who distributed that technology. And all of this also explains why Starfleet had holograms in Star Trek Discovery, which is taking place before the original series, and no one ever used holograms in the original series, so the only explanation is that this is a new timeline, also a whole bunch of other advanced technologies. And all of this can explain why later in Star Trek Discovery we see everybody using holograms all the time, which seems to be even more widespread than in later Star Trek shows. For example, in TNG time, they did have some holographic emitters in their quarters, but they had to have some kind of plate where the hologram appears, and yet in Star Trek Discovery, every single room is basically like a holodeck. You can project anything you want in the room. Maybe the holograms are not tangible, so it's not the same, not as advanced as the ones in TNG, but still it seems way too advanced for the time period. And so my theory is that Star Trek Discovery is taking place in a new timeline which was created after Enterprise. Also, Captain Archer was specifically mentioned in an episode of Star Trek Discovery as the last human who ever set foot on the Klingon planet, and that only happened as a result of the temporal Cold War, because of what the Suliban did, and the Suliban got their instructions from the future, and that was the only reason that the Enterprise went to the Klingon planet, and yet this event was mentioned in Star Trek Discovery. So this is kind of a proof that Star Trek Discovery is taking place in this new timeline following the events of Star Trek Enterprise. So what other proof do I have that Reed actually stole those devices that Daniels left in his quarters? Well, in episode 19 of season 1, called Acquisitions, we see a group of Ferengi taking over the Enterprise, and they search the entire ship for a safe where the Enterprise is keeping all its gold or its money, and yet they never find such a safe. This was just a few episodes after that room was sealed by Reed. So how come the Ferengi, if they indeed searched the entire ship as they said, how come none of them stumbled into that locked room and wondered why is there a giant lock sealing that room? So wouldn't they think that safe is there? Wouldn't they try to break into that room which contains all those devices that Daniels had? So this is a big continuity mistake in season 1 of Enterprise, and so my theory kind of explains that as well. We can assume that Reed actually secretly opened that door and took all those devices, and maybe he secretly shipped those devices somewhere else to be reverse engineered, maybe by Section 31, and that's why the Ferengi never found that. And later he got those devices back and put them back in its place so that Archer or future agents will never know that someone actually studied and reverse engineered those devices. And another proof I have is that just three episodes after that, Reed also invents the first force field in Starfleet. In episode 22 called Vox Sola, Reed casually mentions that he's been working on a new prototype of a force field, even though he did say that Starfleet is also working on that, and that's how he had the specs, but it was still fishy how was Reed, who is not even a scientist, is a security officer, that Reed is able to accomplish something that Starfleet scientists were not yet able to accomplish. They've been working on it for 5 years, and suddenly, in just one day, Reed manages to make the force field work, which the rest of Starfleet wasn't able to. So that is also a very big clue that maybe Reed actually got the technology from one of those devices, which he secretly studied and reverse engineered, maybe in collusion with Section 31, and maybe they kept that knowledge and later gave some of it to Starfleet, which explains why Starfleet had so many technologies before the time they're supposed to have them. Because we know that in the original series, the Enterprise's shuttle bay didn't even have a force field. They were always depressurizing and pressurizing the shuttle bay whenever a shuttle was going out or in, and they didn't seem to have a force field in the shuttle bay. They did use force fields in all kinds of other occasions, like in prison cells and stuff like that, but it seems to be much more primitive and couldn't even be trusted to hold the air in the shuttle bay. Everybody were always waiting outside of the shuttle bay whenever a shuttle was going in or out. And yet suddenly in Enterprise they introduced force fields which are just as good as the ones in TNG and onward. So that is also very, very strange, and it happened just a few episodes After Reed locked all those things in that room, and Reed basically is the only one who could have done it. And later we find out that Reed is a member of Section 31, or used to be a member, used to be an agent. And so I think we can use all of these clues to make the theory that Reed was actually secretly behind Archer's back, getting some of those devices and sending them off the ship, which would explain why the Ferengi never found it. And he had them reversed engineered and studied by someone in Section 31, and then they gave it back so that he put it back in the room, which explains why later Archer still found those devices. But Section 31 already had that technology. It also explains why in Star Trek Discovery, Section 31 has those holographic cloaks, that they are able to look like other people and they can disguise their ships as other things. So this is very advanced technology which shouldn't exist in this time period. And so the only explanation is that they had this technology thanks to all of this, and that explains how they were able to build that time suit, which seemed to be way more advanced than all the technology even in the later Star Trek shows. And technology in general in all of Starfleet seems to be way more advanced than it was in the original series, or even TNG, or even Deep Space Nine, and even Voyager. So that means a lot of the technologies they have must have came from the future as a result of time travel. And there are many other examples I've used, I explained in other videos, of all kinds of technology that was always been forgotten in the past, which could have boosted up humanity's technology and basically changed the timeline. And we can assume that all the major events still happen the same way. Maybe thanks to the guidance of all kinds of future agents who wanted to make sure that certain events do happen for the sake of the galaxy or for humanity. But a lot of the details kept changing, and so that's why technology of Starfleet kept getting upgraded thanks to all these temporal incursions. So I hope you also enjoyed listening to this. Let me know what you think in the comments below and we can discuss it. Let me know if you agree or disagree, if you like or dislike, what you think about it, and we can continue the discussion in the comment section. And I will see you all next time. Bye bye.